was a man who leads a life of danger. To everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. With every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man. They've given you a number and taken away your name.
All right, this is Nerdwatch, and we're doing our second Let's Play.
And we are going to be doing Alpha Protocol. This was a game that came out, I believe it was initially scheduled for 2009. Am I right? 2009?
Yes, and then it came out in 2000.
It got pushed back by almost 6 months. Something ridiculous. It's been a lot of time in development hell. And might I add that the time that it was actually pushed back was like a week before its initial launch date.
Yes.
So it had not gone gold at that point, so we knew there was something iffy going on. But... And it did come out, it's got a few problems, but it's still fun.
And it's moreover, it's nowhere near as bad a game as the critical reception makes it out to be.
Not at all.
It has some... You'll get some glitchy moments, and you'll get a little bit of... You know, it's not the prettiest game you're ever going to play, but it's definitely, you know, a fun game and a worthwhile buy for anyone... Especially if you like spy fiction, and especially if you like the sort of Mass Effect-style dialogue RPG.
Yeah. Okay, so with that said, we're just going to go ahead and jump right into it. This is the character creation background kind of selection screen, starting at the top here.
So the first choice you have is sort of what you did before you were recruited for the agency you end up working for. And so there are four primary choices. That's soldier, field agent, the sort of sneaky person, tech specialist, and freelancer. Now, all these really mean is where you get a couple points at the beginning, but it's actually completely meaningless because if you want to, you can take the ranks out of where they've been placed and then put them back in wherever you feel appropriate. It's really has more to do with what you want to roleplay.
And that roleplay does actually come into play in the main game. For example, if you choose a soldier, there's a mission where you kind of have to find your way into an embassy of sorts, I believe, that's guarded by United States Marines. Anything else, you kind of have to finagle your way in there, or if you're something like the freelancer and playing kind of more gung-ho, shoot everybody in the face and walk inside. If you're playing soldier, you can just straight up do a Bavarian fire drill on these guys and be like, it's cool, I was you know, a Marine or something, and they let you right in. So that's interesting.
Yeah. There are two special choices. If you choose to be a recruit, you start with no skill points whatsoever. Although, by then, you get some special dialogue options that picking them tends to... It'll give you a couple points, at least, to sort of start to make up for it. If you finish the game having started as a recruit, then you unlock veteran. Now, veteran is different in a couple ways. First of all, obviously, you get a lot more skill points as a veteran. More importantly, there are some more dialogue choices, and there are actually some other weird things that sort of will come up, like, I don't know all of them, because I actually haven't played through as a veteran before, but I do know a couple, and I'll try to point them out to you when we get there. So yeah, we're playing as a veteran.
And we're just going to wreak havoc with the skill point system right off the bat. So, for starters, as you can see, we're taking points out of submachine guns and shotguns. If you are smart, you will do the same thing. Shotguns are lovely if you're in close range, but that's not all the time. Submachine guns are basically the I don't want to waste time with this silly thing that's called aiming. The default option, which cannot be changed, might I add, is to dual-wield these suckers. So you're running around with a couple of MP5s in your hand, spraying and praying, and doing a lot more praying if you want to hit anything. So it's kind of worthless as far as I'm concerned. Some of you may disagree. That's fine. You're entitled to your opinion. But yes, you are wrong. So we're doing stealth and pistols as some of our primary. That's really how you can kind of... In the later sections, you can basically do a waltz. If you have enough points and pistols for one ability called Chain Shot, which we'll be showing off later.
Most importantly, though, if you want to play the game stealthily at all, you need to have both stealth and pistols at level 5, like we've got them, because level 5 stealth gives you master awareness, which means that all the time you can see any nearby enemies, where they are, what direction they're facing, and how alerted they are. Which is, I mean, it's useful for anyone, but it's incredibly important for a stealth-based character.
Imagine having a 3D, like, real-time image of the mini-map from Metal Gear Solid.
Exactly. Moreover, having level 5 in pistols means that in this game, when you're using a pistol, if you hold the aiming reticle over an enemy who's within a certain range, it turns red and you get another set of crosshairs that sort of get close together. And if you fire, once it finishes charging, basically, you get a critical hit, which means, most importantly, the bullet goes wherever you put it, which means you can shoot someone in the head, which ignores armor. And having level 5 in pistols means that you can start aiming that behind cover, which, as a stealthy character, means you can do it without them being able to see you, and then you just literally blind fire and shoot them in the head from 15 meters away.
It's handy, shall we say.
So then, we've got the first two levels in Sabotage, and frankly, we probably won't get that many more in it. The second level of Sabotage makes it easier to pick locks, bypass electronics, and hack computers. We could get, binary invisibility is a useful skill, but frankly, we probably won't waste the points in Sabotage to get it up that far. Technical aptitude is useful because medical familiarity means that when you get shot, you can use your health items faster, and as you get better at it, they heal you more. Toughness, we probably won't put that many more points into it. I've finished the game with only 4 ranks in toughness before. And basically this just means that you start to regenerate your health, your shields faster, and you have you have 150 health instead of 100. Finally, martial arts is actually, excuse me, my favorite way to deal with mooks in the game, because you can literally just, especially with this activated ability, Fury, just run around and kung fu the shit out of your opponents.
So with that said, I think that's pretty much, we have 11 more skill points, or you're just kind of saving those up?
Yeah, you'll note that these are all the way black, and then these are grayed out. You aren't allowed at the beginning of the game to buy skills higher than this, which is actually partially to save people. This game is not particularly difficult, but it can be very, very difficult if you don't spread out your skill points a little bit. If you just put points into, like, stealth, then you're just going to get fucked over when you get into one of the boss fights where they start out knowing where you are.
Mm-hmm.
Once we finish the first campaign, the first sort of major campaign mission, it'll unlock the skills all the way up to here. Once we finish the training missions, it'll unlock them up to here. When we finish the first hub, then we'll have to pick an advanced class, which will unlock 3 skills all the way up to the end. Who knows if we will actually end up doing that, but, who knows.
So, with that said, I think we've wasted enough of your time. Let's go ahead and jump into it.
Sega.
Something noteworthy right off the bat. Sega's actually been doing okay in terms of producing games recently. They had this, which admittedly was not critically well-received.
And it was not financially well-received.
It was not financially well-received, but they had Bayonetta as well. I believe that was a Sega game. Yeah. That did well, and it was fun, if incredibly awkward, to play around anyone else. And Obsidian. It becomes blatantly obvious after a time that this is indeed an Obsidian game. That meaning, wonderful, wonderful ideas, subpar execution. If they got some programmers, they would be a force to be reckoned with.
Uh-oh.
You know, in the Middle East, that's less of an uh-oh and more of a, oh, it's Thursday.
Maybe sometimes.
Okay, yeah. baby crying on the plane, you gotta hate that. It almost has an urge to be shot down.
I have to say, this was a pretty fast emergency response.
Yeah. They really didn't waste a whole lot of time getting there, which is good.
Yeah, this is true.
And here's our introduction to the big bad.
If anyone is to blame for these events... Oh, I thought I turned the subtitles on.
Oh, you... You've ruined everything.
Alpha Protocol.
We'll fix that as soon as we can, folks. Sorry.
Yeah.
And so we start off with a bit of a Mass Effect 2 vibe here. We wake up on an operating table and we have no idea how we got there. Although they didn't take your watch.
Oh, I did turn it on.
Why didn't they take your watch? Have they never seen a James Bond movie?
Probably
it's probably jammed full with EMPs, a Garrett wire, and... I don't know, a topless chick
or
something.
We can already see that there's a guy over there. That's that arrow that's sort of floating above the wall. So, as I was saying, in conversations in this game, it'll give you a short amount of time to make a decision between a certain number of stances. So, unlike Mass Effect, it doesn't actually tell you exactly what you're going to say. Although, genuinely speaking, I feel like I got burned by saying something I didn't mean to say more often in Mass Effect than I did in this game.
Yep. Because your tone can change so much based on what you're saying in that game. This gives you straight up how you're going to present it. The words aren't exactly the same, but the idea is presented fairly well. So,
So generally speaking, X is a sort of a suave, James Bondy type response to whatever they're saying. Y is an aggressive Jack Bauer style, and B is more of a Jason Bourne, very professional, mission-oriented person.
If you watch the developer diaries for this game, they do explicitly refer to the three JBs, James Bond, Jason Bourne, Jack Bauer. They make no secret that this is basically just an homage to every espionage movie, TV show, whatever that you've ever seen. And I think it's better for it.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Like, we're a fan of homages around here.
Yeah.
They're fun to play because we'll just be throwing out references left and right without a doubt. So.
For sure. And then as it says, sometimes you'll have an option to hit A, which, for example, a lot of the time at the beginning here, that'll give you the option to make a veteran comment, whereas if you started as a recruit, it would be a recruit. If you started one of the other ones, you don't actually have options there.
I wasn't sure how long you'd be under. Those tranquilizers wore off fast.
That little glitch there... is a something of an in-joke in the fan community who believe that the entire plot is actually secretly masterminded by the Gelato Man, and we'll meet him late in the game. But
yeah, I guess we're doing Rome kind of last, aren't we? So. Indoctrination. Oh, God, we've been captured by Reapers.
There's a guard outside. Eventually he's going to come check on you. And when he does...
Why wait? Set off an alarm, let him know I'm awake.
What? That'll bring him running.
Saves me the trouble of hunting him down.
Okay, well, that was rather direct. I don't think I chose that one my playthrough.
I have never chosen that one before.
Okay, I have only played this game once. I believe Genome over here has played it twice. Twice?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm sending some guards to tuck you back in.
You said one guard.
Looks like he's brought the rest of his squad.
Oh, good job.
Just more people to kill.
Yep.
Or, well, beat the shit out of.
Looks
All right, here we have hacking.
No, no, no. This is electronics bypass.
Oh, okay. Hacking never mind. Bypasses. It's basically just you choose the. It's got the little maze, kind of like the kind that you see in the menu on Red Robin, kids menus, and you just got to connect the number to the bottom section. Not too hard as long as you pay even the slightest bit of attention.
It can get hard because eventually you'll be doing it and there will be like 9 different circuits that you have to do in like 20 seconds and they get more and more complicated. Mm. So that's not so much fun, but you know. Hey, wait. What?
Oh, man.
Gotcha. That was bullshit.
Did the guy across the room see you?
I don't believe it.
Okay. Because I saw evasion kick in there, am I right?
Oh.
For those of you wondering what I'm talking about there, evasion is somewhat of one of the earlier, quote-unquote, advanced stealth moves, in which if someone sees you or would have seen you, you go momentarily invisible. And it's kind of a safety net of sorts that allows you to a couple extra seconds to get back into cover or knock the dude out or something like that if you are seen.
It's a
lifesaver at certain points.
Especially before you unlock Master Awareness and you can get snuck up on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, at this point, no one can ever sneak up on you, so it's not quite as...
Or at least they shouldn't if you're paying attention.
Yeah.